Thank you so much for joining me. I have so much to share with you. I'm super excited, and I know your time is precious, and I really appreciate you joining me here in my sewing room. We're going to have a little fun today. I've got a cool technique with a specialty ruler to show you that just walked in the door that I've been having some fun with. And I got some interesting mail I want to show you as well. And then I want to talk to you about the love of quilting. We just recorded the 4200 series out in Denver, Colorado. So I was out there recording that with Sarah and the whole crew. And it was wonderful as always. It was exhausting as always. And then we're just going to chat about whatever you want to chat about. So if you've got any questions that have come up for you that you want to ask me, just pop them over there in the chat and I will take a look. And I'm always curious to know about you guys and learn more about you guys. So one of the things that we're going to talk about today is my latest quilt, which is all made out of batiks. So over there in the comments, are you a batik lover? So you can put over there batik lover or not so much, because some people have some super strong opinions about it. And there's this idea in the industry right now that batiks are kind of not in fashion. And so I'm wondering what your thoughts are about that. So put it over there in the chat. And of course, I'm always nosy about where people are watching us from. So pop over there in the chat where you're watching from too, because I always like to see how far flung. We have one woman who watches consistently from South Africa. And oh my goodness, her name just flew out of my head. Or I would say hello to her, but she watches a lot from South Africa, and we've got some from the Netherlands and Australia, New Zealand, so it's always fun to see where people are. Of course, we're here in Louisville, Kentucky, and we are getting ready here in Louisville for the Kentucky Derby, which will be in a couple weeks, and all of the flowers are in bloom, and it's a beautiful day today, and we're getting ready. I think, is Thunder over Louisville? I think it's this weekend, I think. We have this huge celebration just before Derby, 2 weeks before Derby, where there's a massive air show and a humongous fireworks display along the Ohio River. There's an entire bridge that is outfitted with fireworks, and a waterfall of fireworks happen. And normally, it must not be this Saturday, it must be next Saturday, because normally about this time, like, we are all getting buzzed by the Thunderbirds and the Blue Angels, like the whole building, you know, shakes and rattles with the military aircraft that come in for the air show the day of Thunder over Louisville, and the whole place kind of rattles. And I recently sent Sarah and the executive producer of the Love of Quilting show, Vanessa, a photo of a department store. I went into a department store, and here in Louisville, in the spring, just before Derby, there are entire departments in the department store that are just for hats. Fascinators and hats. And of course, hats are like the mainstay of the Derby. You have to have a hat to go to the track. And my husband actually got tickets this year, not for the Kentucky Derby, the running of the race on that Saturday, the first Saturday of May. Typically is out-of-towners go to that. Not a whole lot of locals go to that. It's typically flush with tourists. The locals go the day before on that Friday. And then the whole week before the Derby, we go to the track for, it's called Dawn at the Downs. And so, you know, the sun's coming up, everything's super dark, and just like out of the darkness, you hear the brum, 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 brum of the horses warming up, coming at the track, but you can hear them, but you can't see them. And then through the darkness, the horse emerges and it runs, you know, fast right beside you. And then it goes along the track back into the darkness. It's really kind of cool. So they have Dawn at the Downs that whole week of the Derby that you can go out, and they have like a breakfast buffet. And then, of course, there's no actual racing. They're just warming the horses up and training them. But you get to see the Derby contenders. And of course, the buzz is super cool. So it's quite the excitement here in Louisville, Kentucky. And I hope that you watch it. It's only 2 minutes, right? What other sport is only 2 minutes long? So watch the Derby on that first Saturday of May. It's always fun. So let's see. So if you, I'm not seeing, hey, Jesse, do we have folks who have an opinion about batiks?
Lots of love for batiks.
Lots of love for batiks. I agree. Anybody's like, not so much.
I had figuring out which design to put them in.
The design to put them in. Yeah, and some people feel super strong about not mixing batiks with other kinds of fabric, especially not like solids. That doesn't bother me to mix batiks with other kinds of fabrics, but some people feel super strongly about it. The one thing I would caution you though about batiks is those super dark saturated colors. So the super rich indigo blue, super rich purple, super rich red. Like if something's gonna bleed, it's those batiks because they oversaturate them with the dye. And so for batiks, I will pre-wash my fabric, especially those darker colors. Whereas a regular print, I don't know, it depends on how I'm feeling. Most of the time, no. But for batiks, I certainly will wash it. And then the first time you wash the actual quilt, put a whole bunch of color catchers, those little sheets you can get them at the grocery store. I put in like 4 or 5 in the washing machine. In case there's any dye that kind of lingers away from the fabric, those color catchers should catch it. But be super suspicious of those darker eggplant, darker black, darker blues. Like give them the side eye, because if anything is gonna bleed, it's gonna be those guys. So. I did want to make sure that you are signed up for our newsletter. So in our newsletter, we alert you to things like this, like the live stream, but we also alert you to anything fun we've got going on, any new products that we have walking the door, and any tutorials or worksheets that I think you might find helpful, any reference items that you might find helpful. So make sure you're signed up for our newsletter. And then I wanted to tell you right now, we do have our thread bundle of the month. It's the Dewdrop Fairy Bundle, and she's so cute. Every month we have a different fairy visit us, and this month is the Dewdrop Fairy, and it's lavender, sunshine, and sea mist glide thread, and we have that in both the 5,000 meter cone and the 1,000 meter cone, and we have it at a special price for you, but it's only here. She's only here for the month of April. So in May, we will have a new fairy come and visit us. So snag that fairy while you can. We don't repeat our colors. So just know if you get a fairy that you have, you're building your collection, and it's a nice way to start to build that collection. We do have a roadshow coming up. So if you are in the market for a long arm machine, or you know someone who is in the market for a long arm machine, we have a special educational event on May the 20th here in Louisville, Kentucky. And it's free. It's designed for folks who need educational information because they're considering purchasing a long arm machine. And so we'd love to have you join us. If you want to join us, just give us a call here at the shop or send us an email through the Quilt of Joy website, and we will get you all signed up for that. That's the APQS Roadshow on Saturday, May the 20th. All right, let's take a look at, I got a couple of things to show you. One, I want to talk to you about, so I just got back from Denver, and we record for a week out in Denver, Sarah and I do, and we do 3 to 4 shows a day, and so we get the entire season done in 5 days, and it is really hard. There is a lot that goes into it, and at the end of the day, I'm exhausted. Like, my brain isn't even, like, speaking English well. It's not processing information well. Like, I am just over at the end of the day and kind of melt into the chair. And so this time my husband flew out to meet me that final day of taping. And then we went off to Colorado Springs and spent a little mini vacation in Colorado Springs. And we got to see the Air Force Academy. They still have the chapel. They've built like the shell around the Air Force Academy chapel. So you couldn't go in it or see it because I think it's 2024 is when they're going to take the shell off after the renovations. So we couldn't do that. But the the rental car company, they upgraded my car to a red Mustang convertible. And so we get on the Air Force base, and of course you have to like show them your rental papers, and they have to look in your trunk, and they need to see your driver's license. Like, you have to go through all this stuff, and you have to go through all these barricades. And so we're finally, like, on the Air Force Academy's grounds in our red convertible with the top down, and my husband pulls out the Top Gun soundtrack and starts blaring the Top Gun soundtrack as we're cruising down. I'm sure we weren't the first person, the first people to do that. And then at the end, he's like, wait a minute, Top Gun was Navy. It wasn't Air Force. What are we doing? And I'm like, no, it was still cool. Because they've got all of these, like, they've got all these planes that are, like, mounted, and so, like, they're as if they're taking off, like, statues. I don't know. They're, like, decommissioned planes that they've, like, put on a pedestal, and they've got them, like, kind of tilted, so it looks like they're about to take off over the mountains behind them. And so it makes for a lot of really interesting photo opportunities as you go around there. But one of the things that we did there in Colorado Springs is we went on a falconry tour, and we got to meet some falcons. And I'd never done this before, and I pulled some photos to show you guys. So Rachel's going to put those up on the screen for you. So there were peregrine falcons, there were hawks, there was they were all a little perch. We got to hold them. We had like a leather glove. We had to hold them, and the peregrine falcon let us like pet his little chest. He was so soft. We got to pet his little chest. But one of the cool things was the owl. And Rachel, do you have that video of the owl?
Showed it.
You showed it? Okay, perfect. So this, and I mean, he was a giant owl. And he flew in, and just the sound, like there's no sound when he flies. Like the hawk flies, and you're like, ooh, I heard that. And the owl flies, and yeah, I can see why a mouse is like, what is that? Oh, and then he's dead, right? So on the falconry tour, we went for a walk with the hawk through the woods. And the hawk has a little bell on his talon, and he would fly from tree to tree to tree with us as we were walking through the woods. And our job was to like flush out small critters so that the hawk could like come down and have dinner. And so like just walking through the woods with this bird following us, going from tree to tree, was just a surreal experience. And then we came out into this giant field. It used to be the golf course, like it was huge. And in this field, they had a cable mounted on the field that went around these posts. So it made this giant square. And it started it through this like little tunnel box. And the box wasn't very big, but in the box was this fuzzy tail thing made out of fabric that was tied to that cable. And then they hit this button, and that fuzzy thing went zoom out of that box and around those four corners around this giant field. And I tell you what, that hawk like came out of the tree, whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. And then they had the fuzzy thing as it came around stop right in front of us, and the hawk. So the hawk was like coming right at us, and then bam, landed on that fuzzy thing and dug his talons in. And he was like, I won. This is mine. Get your own, basically, was the message from the hawk. And so then they gave him like a mouse instead. So he let go of the things and took the mouse instead. It was just wonderful. We went on a foodie tour. We took a Jeep tour up to the top of Pikes Peak and looked out over the top of Pikes Peak, which was like 14,000 feet high. And the guy, he said, you know, we think this is a big mountain because it is. But where we're standing at the top of Pikes Peak, so above the tree line, 40% oxygen, you can see to Kansas and New Mexico. He's like, this is still 1,000 feet below base camp on Everest. Base camp on Everest. We're still 1,000 feet below base camp. And I mean, that just like, I like, wow, you know, you think I'm on a big mountain. Yeah, it's big. It's not big, but yeah, it's big. So anyway, that was so much fun. So Gail thinks batiks aren't as snuggly. Sometimes I agree with you, Gail. Batiks do have a crispness to it, and that is because they have a tighter weave. So they just have more threads per square inch than a regular quilter's cotton. So I agree, they can be a little crisper and not as drapey as a quilter's cotton would be, yeah. And so Cindy says they're great for applique, and so that's why they're great for applique, because they are crisper. You can get a nice cleaner sweep of that edge if you're doing needle turn. It's been a while since I've done needle turn applique, Cindy. I've started to develop arthritis in the base of my thumb on my right hand. And so like even like picking up a coffee cup or like picking up my purse or my computer off the ground, like that is super hard for me. So I have yet to try some hand work. Anyway, if you guys have any information or something, like, I don't know what will help that, but it's just the base of my thumb on my right-hand side. Pop there in the chat and see if you have any suggestions for me that might help the relieve that pain a little bit. Marilyn asks, what do you think about mixing batiks and quilting cottons? Marilyn, I say go for it. I just think that you might, I'm not a big fan of solids mixed with batiks, but watch, somebody will prove me wrong. They'll make this glorious quilt and I'll be like, yep, that's exactly why that works just great. Works just great. Okay, I want to show you the latest edition of the Love of Quilting magazine. Should I put it over here, Rachel? Is that better?
Yeah.
Is that good? Mm-hmm. Okay, so here's the latest edition of Love of Quilting magazine, and that's my quilt. They never tell me, you know, if I'm on the cover or not. This is the third cover, I think. The third cover with my quilt. It's the fourth cover total. The one of the covers that had my name on it, which was awesome. But this, I'm always thrilled when I see my quilt. And they do such a good job at the magazine taking photos of it. So it's all of batiks. And these are all some new batiks that we just got into the shop. These are all Riley Blake expressions. And I don't know how to say the word. They're tejops. I don't think I'm saying that correctly. But it's like an Indonesian style batik, and they are so yummy. They are so yummy. That's like the best way I can describe a batik, is they are just yummy, yummy, yummy. And we've got fat quarter stacks. We've got it also by the yard. And here's the other one I pulled. There's a number of them downstairs. This one's called Farmer's Market. This other one with the blues, that one's called April Showers. And it's got the blues and the pinks and the yellows and the greens. So pretty. This one is Farmer's Market. And this one has the colors, some of the colors that are in that quilt. And hopefully you can see it. So it's got a, like lighter greens and tealy blues and watery blues. This one is in the quilt. And then some brown. So those are some fat quarter stacks. And let me show you the quilt itself. So here is, it's called Sea Glass Star, and it's a wall hanging, and it uses banded flying geese. So banded flying geese. And there is the finished quilt. And so this outside border is all banded flying geese. But if that makes you a little queasy, it's actually not hard to do. It's quite cool. It's the same method to make this geese here. See how the geese, the sky, are banded? It's made out of a strip set. The skies are. And the goose is a plain piece of fabric. And then these are all the same way. They're just smaller geese. And so then the cornerstones are just a smaller version of this large dude. But you could just make the large dude. But we have this as a kit. So you can find this on the website. And it actually, I got the inspiration from this one. This was in a previous magazine. This one is Michelle Mishler, her Happy Homes, Sweet Happy Homes pillow. And she made these little flying geese as the roof tops to these houses. But she put a chimney in them by creating a strip set for one side of the geese. And I was like, I am going to play with that technique because that looks like it has a lot of possibilities. And that's how I came up with this star that has the banded. And I was calling this an Ohio star, but you could also call it a sawtooth star. So, you know, just like with quilting, there's a lot of things that are called different names. And then I wanted to show you one other thing in here. This was so much fun. So they had a postcard swap. Have you guys ever done a quilted postcard and put it in the mail? So what they did is a few editions of the magazine back, they asked people to send in a postcard. And then they sent them out, the staff there divvied them up and sent them out. So you didn't know who was going to send you a postcard, nor did you know where your postcard was going. And so mine showed up recently. I'm going to show you over here. This is the one that showed up for me. Isn't that sweet? It's a needle turn applique, and it's got some hand embroidery on it as well. And all the leaves are needle turn. And then don't you love that gingham out? And then she did some free motion quilting on the back of it. And it says, you're sweeter than cherry pie. And it's from Beverly. And it just came with a regular old stamp on it here to the shop. So thank you, Betty, if you were out there. I loved seeing your postcard. It was a lot of fun to have the mail walk in and find a little cherry in the stack of mail. So thank you, Betty. Put over there in the chat if you've ever done a quilted postcard. This was my first time to do it. So. Cindy says she was thinking machine applique with the batik. Yeah, yeah, that's certainly easier than needle turn for sure, right, Cindy? And Linda says maybe a compression sleeve. Linda, you know, I was actually thinking about Dolly Parton is who I was thinking of, because she wears those gloves like all the time, and I think their compression, they just make her feel better about the look of her hands. You know, hands are one of those places you can't hide aging. So she wears those gloves everywhere, but I bet they're compression too. So I thought about compression gloves as well. I don't know. I tried compression tights, I think they're called, leggings, on a 15-hour flight to New Zealand once. And like at the end of it, I was like, I can't stand these things. Get them off my feet. So I don't know if I'd feel the same way about a compression sleeve. Andrea says she warms hers up with Bengay. Oh, so the heat of it is what helps, Andrea. Okay, it's too bad that Bengay smells so stinky. I bet they have a version of it now that doesn't smell so stinky. But when I was pregnant with my triplets, my back was in so much pain from all of that that I would just slather Bengay on my back to try to get some relief. And I just smelled high heavens the whole time. It would probably turn my nose at this point because that Bengay is like seared in my brain from being pregnant with my kiddos. All right, so we do have, by the way, we do have autographed copies of this magazine that has my quilt on the cover there at quiltedjoy.com that you could get. And of course, like I said, we do have that quilt as a kit. Okay, so that was the latest edition of the magazine that just came out. And the other thing I wanted to ask you is, you guys are so awesome about supporting our little shop and supporting all the quilt fairies. And we have been nominated for the 2023 Fonson Porter Love of Quilting Reader's Choice Awards. And I would love it if you would take the time to vote for us. You don't have to vote in every category, but the three categories that we are nominated in are Best Online Fabric Store, Best Online Quilting Supplies, and Best Independent Quilt Shop. And so if you would go and vote, you don't have to vote for every category, but it would just make such a huge difference in our little business and our ability to you know, provide you with more and more content and more support. If you would go and vote for us, it would mean a lot to me. So that's where you can go and vote for the Reader's Choice Award. Okay, so in that Sea Glass Star quilt, we are talking about, here's the center of that Sea Glass Star quilt. And so this is what I was saying to you, that some people call it an Ohio Star. It could also be called a Sawtooth Star, but it's a very simple block to make. And you can make the block, this one's fairly large. So it's got that large center, four flying geese, and then four cornerstones as well. Polly says collagen helped her arthritis. Like you take it, like you swallow it, or you
collagen powder
on your skin?
No, you take it. You can put it in your coffee.
You drink the collagen powder.
You can dissolve it in your coffee.
Huh. All right. Andrea says she cast her vote. Thank you, Andrea. Fran and Linda both recommend Voltaren. That must be is that an over-the-counter or a prescription? Voltaren. All right, I'll have to look, Fran and Linda. Thank you for that. And collagen, collagen powder. Okay, all right. Yeah, getting old's no fun. No fun at all. Okay, so we are talking about this unit, the Ohio Star, the Sawtooth Star, and I wanted to show you the quilt that we had talked about at the beginning of the month. So we've been working our way through some of these three-yard quilt books. And so the quilt that we did at the beginning of this month in Clubhouse was Fascination Out of the Magic of Three-Yard Quilts. And what's awesome about the three-yard quilt books is that they show you multiple sizes of the same quilt. So for example, here's that Fascination that we talked about, and I showed you how to quilt an Ohio star, that's sawtooth star, during the April, the earlier April of Clubhouse meeting. And so in the book, it shows you how to make the finished size here, 44 by 60, but it also shows you how to make a twin, how to make a queen king. So there are multiple sizes in this one book. And so the 3 yard, so these all come from a 1 yard cut of three fabrics. And so a 1 yard cut of three fabrics will give you that smaller size, that lap size. 2 yards of the three fabrics will give you a twin. And 4 yards of the three fabrics will give you a king queen. And we have curated the 3 yard bundles here with the ones we know will work well for these quilts. And so this month we were talking about the button drop 3 yard bundle. So it's 1 yard cut of three different fabrics. We're calling it a button drop. And so I've mocked it up in Electric Quilt to show you what that 3 yard bundle looks like using this Ohio Star Sawtooth Star that we're talking about. And so, Rachel, are you able to see this? Okay, perfect. So that's that smaller. That is that that lap size. And so let's just like think about it. So you've got like a swath of focal print, and then you've got your star. And then this is a block with just strips, you know, framed out, and it alternates throughout. So that's the lap size. And of course, the pattern is in that Magic of 3 yard Quilt book with all the instructions and the sizing. And then here is the twin, and then there is the king queen. And so by having just these long swaths of fabric of your focal print, it just makes for a very quick and fast quilt. So let's look at how to put this block together, this same sawtooth star, Ohio star that was in the sea glass star quilt that was on the cover of the magazine. Okay, I've got so much stuff. I'm just going to throw it all over here. All right. So Janice asks the difference between the pros and cons of batting with and without scrim. Great question, Janice. So let's talk about that, and then I'm going to show you the Ohio star, the sawtooth star. So batting has a scrim. Many bats, not all bats, many bats have scrim. And scrim is a polypropylene mesh, kind of like an organza or a tulle. And they put it on the back of the batting. So batting is needle punched, typically. So it's all these fibers, and then there's this big honking thing with all these needles that compresses and punches, needle punches the batting to felt it, basically, to compress it into batting. And where the needles go in, they make little dimples, and where the needles come out, they make little pimples. And if you look at the back of batting that has been needle punched, the back of it looks like an old pilly sweater, like a super old pilly sweater. And those pills go against your backing fabric. And if you are quilting with a long arm machine, you are quilting with a giant needle, like a big honking 18 gauge needle. And so that scrim, if you use batting with a scrim, that scrim that is on the backside of the batting, which you would put against the backing fabric of your quilt, that scrim acts like a fence or a gate to try to prevent as much of the batting from bearding out the backside of your quilt as possible. If you do have a long arm machine and you're looking at your take-up bar and you see little tufts of batting come out the backside, and you know you've got a batting with scrim, you know you got it positioned the correct way on your frame, that is a sign of a dull needle. So go change your needle and all those little pieces of batting that are coming out the back will go away. But I personally, if I'm going to quilt it on a long arm machine, I personally want a scrim on it. That just helps keep things under control because I'm going after it with a giant needle. So my preference is for a scrim. All right, I hope that was helpful, Janice. Okay, so let's talk about, where did I go? Right here. Let's talk about the basis for this block is a flying geese. And I never know what a single flying geese, is it a goose, a flying goose? But here's our flying goose. Now, let's talk about the anatomy of our goose. So our goose is this portion. It's that V portion, that mountain portion of the unit. Like the geese are flying, you know, south for the winter or north for the summer. They have this point that they come into. Some people call this the nose of the goose. I tend to think about geese flying, but it could also be the nose of the goose. And then you've got sky on each side. And so there are a variety of ways that you can create a flying goose unit. Typically, though, in a block, you're using more than one. And of course, in our block, we're using four total. So let's look at how we would make this the flying goose unit. So I've got our background fabric here, and this is going to eventually be the goose part, and then I'm going to put the sky part. For the sky part, I have these smaller, where did my other sky? Oh, here he is. Excuse me, I'm going to cough. Sorry. So here's my sky, and this will be my goose. And I've already, I don't know if you can see it, but I've already marked, Rachel, can you see that I've already marked? Okay. All right, so I'm going to lay this down from corner to corner. And here's the tip I have for you. Don't align it right on the edge. Come in just a little tiny, like just a few little hairs of that fabric, just a few little hairs. And so I've got a diagonal line marked from corner to corner, and I'm using flannel, so if I just, I don't need a pen, I just, and it stays right where I want it. Okay, now we're gonna sew 1/4 inch away from each side of that marked line. All right, so I'm gonna go down. Sew on that line, and when I get to where they're kind of overlapped, I slow down just a touch, and then head it down, and then I'm just going to turn the sucker around, and I typically will just go needle up, and I hit the needle button instead of the needle up button. All right, let me try that again. I typically just go around the bend, and then put the needle back down. You know, I do that. I'll go, oh, I'm gonna thread my needle. And no, what I've done is I've hit the little scissor button. All right, so we'll go down. And of course, I production sew this, right? I get a bunch of these going at a time. Now I'm gonna hit the scissor button. Okay, so we have sewn on both sides of that diagonal. And now we are ready to cut on that line. And I'm just gonna move my little camera over here so that hopefully you guys can see a little bit better. So there is my two blocks we've sewn on each side of the diagonal, and now I'm ready to cut through that line. And so we're gonna talk about this tool I'm gonna use here in just a minute, but I'm just gonna use it to give me a straight edge so that I can break this apart. We are gonna be using this specialty ruler in just a minute. Looks like I didn't quite get it. There it goes. And then come up to here and put it in. Why bring it in? Janice says, why bring it in? Janice, I'm not sure what, why bring it in? Oh, bring those four corners. You'll see here, Janice, it just gives you a little bit more wiggle room for your accuracy. Okay, so here's what we just did. Yeah, and I've cut from corner to corner. So now I have these two units. And so now I'm gonna press these little ears up and out. And Janice, it doesn't take long. It doesn't take much. Just come in a few little threads from your larger square, and it will increase your accuracy. Okay, and then typically when I am pressing like this, so I'm gonna lay it down and I'm ready to do this one, I'll put it right below the one I just did, so that now when I go to press this one, I'm actually pressing that other one at the same time. So both are getting pressed again. And then I'm using the bulk of the iron, the weight of the iron, the heat of the iron to have those little ears. Some people say that it looks like a little fox. Can you see the little fox? Some people says it looks like a little heart, but that's what we're after. Okay, so then the next piece that we're gonna do is we're gonna put the next square on. So you'll need another square of that dark green fabric, and you're gonna place it, and I've got one here done already, and you will place it. So notice, don't get lost. Here's where we were. There's our fox or our heart. And then we're gonna put another one of those green squares here just inside. So here it is, gonna mark from corner to corner, sew on each side of the diagonal. And that now we're gonna cut on that diagonal. So I'm gonna cut on that little diagonal. And that will give us a goose. But he's a hairy goose. He's a goose with opinions. And so we've increased our accuracy by making these just a little bit bigger than they need to be. And then I'm gonna show you this specialty ruler where we can trim it down and have perfection. And that will really help everything lie nice and flat, which will also help in the machine quilting process. Kathleen asks, do you recommend piecing to the side or open when you plan to long arm? Kathleen, I almost always, and I mean always, almost always, press to the side. Because when you press open, the problem is that if you want to stitch in the ditch, as your needle goes through the ditch, it can pierce the piecing thread. So you're breaking the thread that you need to hold the thing together. So it eliminates that choice. If I'm gonna long arm it and the seams are pressed open, I just can't stitch in the ditch. I can stitch to the side of the ditch. I could stitch like an eighth of an inch away from the ditch, but I can't stitch in the ditch. And so it just limits my choices. So I almost always press to the side. Okay, so we were talking about the specialty ruler. I want you to see this ruler. So this one is, can you see it okay?
Yes.
Okay, it has a little glare on it, but I think.
I have a picture of it, I can put it too.
Okay, all right, so this is the Creative Grids Ultimate Geese Tool. And it has all of the information about the sizing that you need of the fabric to make the flying geese. And you could use the QR code if you wanna see a video on how it's done from the Creative Grids folks. But what's nice about this tool is that look at how many sizes of geese it can make. Can you see that? Here, maybe if I go up here. Is that better?
Yeah. Oh. Put it back a little bit. Yeah.
Okay. So look at all those. So from one inch by a half inch all the way up to a 4x8 goose from this one ruler. And I happen to have a little tiny goose. Look how cute he is. Isn't he adorable? So this goose is gonna be a 1x2 goose. Whereas the goose that we just did, who's all ready that we still need to trim up, he's a much bigger goose. He is a 4x8 goose. He's a 4x8 goose. So this one tool can do, you can go even smaller. That's not as small as it'll go. That's the 1 inch by 2 inch. It can go down to a 1/2 inch by 1 inch goose with this one tool. So let's take a look. So the tool itself has two different sizes. It has the trim one side, and it has on the other side the trim two side. And so like I said, this one piece of acrylic can do all those sizes. So let's look at how you use it now that we have our goose made, because he's all ratty and unruly, and we're gonna make him look all nice and fresh and like he's ready to go for a quilt. The other cool thing about the Creative Grids rulers is they've got this nonstick portion. It's not over the whole thing, but it means you won't need like Invisigrip or something or sticky dots or anything on the back. It's built into the tool itself, and we have a number of these different Rulers from Quilter's Grid. Yeah, Becky says it's the best one ever. I agree, Becky. I really like it. Okay, so there's our goose. Like, he just got out of bed. And so I'm just going to take the trim one side. And so that trim one side, it has the little dots, the little dash lines that I will use on the nose of the goose.
Can you
to
up just a little bit?
This way?
The whole thing, just up a little bit.
Up a little bit?
Yeah.
Is that better?
You're getting cut off at the bottom.
Oh, okay. So. Is that better?
There you go. That's better.
Oh, and that helps with the glare, too. Okay, so I've got the nose of the goose in those dashed lines so that I know exactly where my goose should be. And then I'm just going to trim my goose down. So I've got two sides. And I felt like when I went over his nose, of course, I'm sitting down. There it goes. And then I'm going to rotate this around. And now when I rotated him around, rather than this trim one side, I'm going to rotate it around and use this second side. And the second side, now I don't have to worry about the nose of the goose. I mean, I can, it's there's a line there, but I just lay him down and I'm really just worried about this line down here. So this line down here, it says 4x8, and that's the size goose I'm after, is the 4x8 goose. Remember, it goes all the way up. Look how tiny he is. One half inch by one inch goose. He's a tiny little goose. He's a baby goose. We're going to do the papa goose. So I've got him sitting down there, and I've got my goose nose in that triangle shape, and then I'm just going to trim those last two sides. And there you go. There's my goose, and it's just a little bit that gets cut off, but by pulling those two squares on the side in just a little bit, it'll get you a perfect goose. Okay, so I told you I have those little baby geese that were 1 inch by 2 inch. Aren't they adorable? Okay, so to make the Ohio Star, you just need that center square, and then we have our geese that are gonna fly around. I'm gonna move this up a little bit, Rachel. So we have our little geese that are gonna make the points of the star. Yeah. And then we have our four cornerstones to make that sweet. Isn't it sweet? So stinking sweet. So that 1 inch by 2 inch goose, he starts the same way that our other goose did, with the larger square that will become the goose, and then our two little sky squares. We draw a diagonal line, we'd sew on each side, we'd cut it, we'd open it up to make little fox ears, and then we'd put our additional squares to complete the goose, and then use that trim tool to get the appropriate size, whatever the appropriate size is that you're after. So take a look at the pattern, but any goose that you come up with, it, with any pattern that you're doing, this is a great way to do flying geese. It's just not as stressful, and it has all of the sizes and everything on the tool that come in it, so that you know what size to cut that outer square, and you know what size to cut those smaller squares, that you can make whatever size geese you want and just use one tool to do it. So if you haven't picked up a tool specifically for geese, I recommend this one. It's a nice one. There's another one I like too by Deb Tucker, but this one is a nice one as well. They're both good. Okay, so I did want to tell you that next month on May the 3rd, so that'll be just before Derby, at 1 o'clock Eastern, we're going to talk about quilting secondary blocks. So I hope that you are able to join me there. If you are going to Paducah, Kentucky next week for the big quilt show, come give me a hug. I'm going to be in the APQS long arm booth playing the long arm machines. So Sarah will be there as well. Sarah's just going to like check out the quilts. She's just going walking around. So keep your eye out for Sarah. Give her a hug too. But if you are going to Paducah, come visit me. Come say hi. I want to meet you. I want to say hello and I want a hug. So the next time we'll meet is on May the 3rd, and that's at 1 o'clock Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific. We're going to be quilting on secondary blocks. And then do watch for us on over on Facebook. We'll be posting some information about and some quilts from Paducah as well. And then on Instagram, I'll have some photos I'm going to share with you from the Paducah trip as well. I'll be there from Tuesday through Saturday. So if you've never been to Paducah, I mean, just you need to like make it a bucket list kind of thing to do because the quilts are phenomenal. And it's a sweet little town that's just completely focused on quilts for that week. And then, of course, over on YouTube, you can watch all of the past episodes of our Quilted Joy Clubhouse. So thank you so much. Oh, Janice asked, are the markings finish sizes? Yes, correct. So the markings are finish sizes. So you don't have to think about that part, Janice. Yes. So it finishes at 4x8. But technically it's 4.5x8.5. So you're exactly right, Janice. You're exactly right. But you don't even have to think about it because the ruler does all the thinking for you. All right, you guys, I will talk to you later. And thank you so much for joining me. I hope you have a wonderful day and I'll see you in May.